Ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to reach you live once again. You know, wherever you are watching me from today, I'm very, very happy, and it's going to be a glorious weekend for us all. Yes, I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes with you, gisting, because there have been too many issues, you know, going on in our country, Nigeria. So someone is disturbing me on Facebook. So yes, let's discuss as always. Let's discuss freely and candidly. You know, a few of us will always tell it as it is, without mincing words, without fighting anybody, without being rude, without being pugnacious. You know, our duty is to speak truth to ourselves, speak truth to our friends in government, in power, you know, and I don't even know where to start from, because there are just too many things to discuss today. But then I still have to write 2,000 words this evening for This Day newspaper and The Boss newspaper coming out tomorrow morning in Nigeria. So Fridays are usually very, very busy for me, but I just feel the time has come for me to speak up on some of the developing events in Nigeria. Of course, the trending topic right now is the arrest of Chief Sunday Igboho Adeyemo in Benin Republic earlier in the week. And since I have experience about, you know, some of these things, yeah, I think it's only fair that I speak about it. I've seen all kinds of ignorant arguments, especially on social media, people saying A or B or C or D, but I want to give you my own perspective. Okay? I will start with asylum. A lot of people of this generation are probably not aware that some of us have passed through this same route before. On July 25th, 1995, yes, July 25th, 1995, I left very early in the morning, very, very early, this is 26 years ago now, I left very early in the morning, and I had to cross the border, the Seme border, into Cotonou, you know, disguised like I was going into my farm. You know, I was on the run from General Sani Abacha. This was July 25th, 1995. So by, in the next, what's today's date again? Today's 23rd. So on Sunday, it will be exactly 26 years ago that I fled Nigeria. 26 years ago that I fled Nigeria on the run from General Sani Abacha. It's a shame that Nigeria is back to those days whereby people have to start running away from their country. At any rate, I was going to be arrested, and I managed to escape through Cotonou, through Seme border. We couldn't go through the normal, usual immigration processes So a friend of mine who had escaped before me, the famous senator Tokunbo Afikuyomi, so I had to call him when my life was endangered, and so he told me what to do, how to get an ECOWAS passport, and the ECOWAS passport I would need so that I can at least get out of Nigeria, but I couldn't use my regular passport. On that regular passport, I had a multiple visa to Britain. I had a 2-year visa, valid visa to Britain, but I couldn't use that, I couldn't risk it. So I have three friends with me who accompanied me. One of them, a big brother of mine, is late now, Captain Rotimi Seriki. God bless his soul, God bless his soul, God bless his soul. You know, I love him to bits. He was one of the few people who could tell me anything in this world and I would listen to him. And he loved me so much that he had to risk everything. He had to risk his career as a pilot with the Nigeria Airways, and he accompanied me on that trip. Of course, I also had Ome Yemi Basharun, Bola Orolugbagbe. He was the second man to volunteer to go with me. And I also had Mr. Olakunle Sikiru Bakare, the publisher of Encomium magazine, my very, very dear friend and brother. So three of them took this journey of faith with me. It was tough. It was scary. We got to a place in the bush, and it was time for me to lead the way. So I was going in front. I was not carrying anything on me. My face is easily recognizable, and I've never been that scared in my life. So the three of them were coming behind. One of them was carrying my bag, another was carrying my passport, and you know. So to cut a long story short, we managed to cross into Cotonou, this same Cotonou where Sunday Igbo was arrested. And I looked back at my country, Nigeria, and I started crying. I broke down in tears. I wept bitterly. I wept bitterly. I didn't know where precisely I was going. I didn't know if I would get there. I didn't know when I would get there. I didn't know if I would ever return to my country, Nigeria. I had what we call in literature stream of consciousness. You know, I was soliloquizing, I was thinking, and you know, and my brain was working at supersonic speed. So what if Abacha's people have discovered that I've escaped and they pursue me to Cotonou? So we quickly went to a safe house, what we call a safe house. Captain Seriki had arranged a safe house where I was able to quickly discard my old clothes, what I was wearing, and I changed my dress, and they saw me off to a car garage where I boarded a car to Lome in Togo. I wanted to be far, far, far away from Nigeria, so that's why I had to go to Togo. Even getting to Togo, I was still not comfortable. I immediately boarded another vehicle from Aflao station, Aflao border, which is the border of Ghana and Togo. So I boarded another vehicle from where I fled to Ghana. And that was my first day ever in Ghana. I slept at an hotel called Noga Hill Hotel. It was quite new then, in Jowolo, somewhere around Jowolo, you know. And from there, you know, I then plotted my escape. You see, because my papers, and this is where Igbo comes in, my papers were not perfectly in order. You know, for you to move from country to country, you are expected to stamp your passport first from your country of departure, which is Nigeria. I couldn't do that. So which meant I left Nigeria illegally. So I could not stamp my passport in Nigeria. But I managed to get, because it's an ECOWAS country, a lot of people move freely, which is what it's supposed to be. I'm supposed to be able to show my ID card and just show my ID card and say, hey, I'm a West African, I'm a Nigerian, and I'm traveling to the next country. But you know, Africa, our own, is always different. So, but I managed to penetrate and to get to Ghana, but I had my ECOWAS passport. So now the next challenge is if you enter a country, you are also expected to exit that country with the passport that took you into the country. And because I was now going to England and my visa was not on my ECOWAS passport but on my Nigerian passport, it meant I needed to put, so I now need to get out of the Accra airport. Somehow, I must be able to convince immigration that I'm switching passport from the blue passport to the green passport that contained my British visa to be able to leave the country. I spent a whole of 3 days planning that. Fortunately, I had friends in Nigeria, in Ghana already. I was able to locate one of them. He was very, very helpful. He later became a minister in Ghana. You know, he followed me to the airport and made sure that I was checked through all the way to boarding the British Airways flight that took me from Ghana to London. So, when people say this passport, that passport, when you are fleeing from persecution, you will do anything. And it is recognized globally that anyone fleeing persecution will do anything. It's called survival instinct. Some people have said, that Sunday Igbo was not fleeing persecution, but prosecution. I'm not aware that he was being prosecuted in any court of law in Nigeria. I don't know. So lawyers, I've just read a release by Mr. Femi Falana or SAN, in which he also dissected all these issues I'm raising. So I am not a competent lawyer, but as I said, I am not aware that I was under prosecution. And one of the areas, in which Igbo is likely to be defended by his lawyers is the fact that the night his home was invaded in Ibadan, 2 people were actually killed. Summarily, were not aware that they resisted arrest, but they were killed. And over 12 people were carried physically and taken away as hostage and kept incommunicado. So, again, he will say if his assailants had met him at home, he would have been one of those killed summarily. And you know, in Nigeria, nothing is going to happen. Nobody is going to challenge them. So those people are dead, and the dead remains dead. So I believe that is whatever the situation is. There have been arguments that he didn't have a valid passport, or he had a valid passport. I've read somewhere where his wife said, no, they had their valid passports, that they did not do anything illegal. I don't know. So until they get to court now on Monday, since the case has been adjourned to court on Monday, that is when I believe, those issues will be raised and addressed, and then the court of law will decide. That is not with. I'm just talking about my own personal experience. Now, getting to London, the next thing is, how was I going to stay in London beyond? Because normally London will give you 3 months stay based on your visa. You're allowed 3 months. Even that 3 months, you're not supposed to spend the whole of 3 months. But in my own case, I arrived in July. By October, so I was getting pressure that I may become an illegal alien. I was hoping that General Sani Abacha will calm down, the same way I'm hoping that Nigeria will calm down. You see, because we are fighting too many battles, and General Muhammadu Buhari has less than 2 years to go. Unless there is something else we don't know, he has less than 2 years to go. In fact, by now, his government should be wrapping up and getting ready to hand over power in less than 2 years. You know, so we don't really have much time again. So all this fight that we're fighting, this is the time actually that you should be consolidating power, and whatever achievements is achieved in the last 6 years plus, this is the time that it should fully stamp its signature on those achievements, so that history will be fair and kind to him. So I'm sure he must have achieved something in those 6 years. So I don't want, that's not the basis of my broadcast today. So I'm talking about asylum. So, of course, I consulted my lawyers, led by Prince Adedamola Aderemi, the Prince of Ile-Ife. Of course, he's my best friend. Whatever I'm doing, he will be involved. And then he sat down with experts, and they looked at what I needed to do. In my own case, my life was under threat from General Sani Abacha. I was known to be one of the closest, you know, if you say supporters of Chief Moshood Kajimawo Olawale Abiola. I had enough evidence of my activities. I was first arrested in July, between July and August 1993, immediately after the election. I was probably the first person to be arrested by the Babangida government. And so after I was released, we kept on with our campaign for the revalidation of the June 12 mandate, which had been annulled by General Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida. So I had more than enough evidence that if I was sent back to Nigeria, my life would be in danger. There is nobody, whether you support Igbo or you don't support him, who can guarantee what will happen to Igbo if he is sent back to Nigeria. So the way he is going to be treated and the way he is expected to be treated is as a prisoner of conscience. What is Igbo's purported offense? That he said his people were being killed by Fulani herdsmen, and that enough is enough, and that they needed to defend themselves, and there is no evidence that he has killed one soul, none that I'm aware of. If anybody knows, then let them present it to the international community. I don't think he has killed anybody. He has been in his house. He's not in the forest, like the terrorists who have been in the forest, who openly display their weapons of mass destruction before the media, before Sheikh Gumi, before the police, before the army. They are there. They know their location. Sheikh Gumi drives in and out of the bush to go and negotiate with them. Nobody has made any effort to arrest or to attack them or to even call them their true name, which is, you are a terrorist. Nobody has done that so far. So it's going to be argued that Sunday Igbo is being persecuted because, if you read all those who have supported the government, they are saying because he's preaching secession. So I'm going to address that in a minute too. That, so is it illegal for someone to say, I am tired of a country? You see, a country, the citizens of a country are in a marriage, especially in a multi-ethnic, multi-religious country such as ours. It's a marriage. And a marriage is expected to be convenient for the parties involved in the marriage. Okay? A marriage. One of the reasons why a marriage can be dissolved is when it becomes inconvenient for either or both parties. As a matter of fact, the easiest way to dissolve a marriage is when there is what they call irreconcilable differences. For example, husband and wife can say, in the last 3 years, we have not slept in the same bed. We have not conjugated. We have not respected each other. We have been slapping each other in the house in the presence of the children, and we are tired of doing this, and we want to go our separate ways. It's as simple as that. Where Sunday Igbo and other agitators become liable is when they carry weapons and wage war against their country. What they are doing now is a dream. Anybody can dream. People are dreaming of paradise. There are Christians who are dreaming that when they die, they will go to paradise. Nobody has been to paradise and back. It's a dream. Those who want the Yoruba nation, they are dreamers. They are dreaming of a better nation where they will not be treated as second class and third class citizens. It's a dream. It remains a dream. Carrying placard. If tomorrow I decide I am tired of Nigeria and I carry a placard and I say I am tired of Nigeria, you cannot prosecute me for that. It's my wish. It's my dream. Even today, I've just posted press revolution saying that if Nigeria continues at this speed and we don't decentralize urgently, there is nobody who can guarantee the survival of Nigeria. So you cannot say Chweneyagae has committed an offense and then you want to go and arrest him. It's a dream. The people that you need to pursue are those who have carried weapons against Nigeria and Nigerians. People who have shot down multi-million dollar fighter jets. Those are the real criminals. But for someone who is dreaming of a Yoruba nation, let him dream. And I like to cite the example of the Irish Republican Army. Go and read the story of the Republic of Ireland and all the trouble that they went through. They had a political wing called Sinn Féin. Go and check the stories. The government had to negotiate with them. The people of Britain decided that they are tired of Europe. I was one of those who said, oh, but why are they pulling out of a bigger economy, bigger union? And they had a referendum. And during the referendum, overwhelmingly, people voted to pull out of Europe. Nobody called them, they are unpatriotic, they are this, they are that. No. There is no law that says you must be a part of a country by fire, by force. As I said, except where you carry weapons against your country, everybody has a right to dream. So if tomorrow I am tired of my wife, I should be able to tell my wife I am tired. And my wife cannot say, oh, you are going nowhere. Because when we signed in the law court, in the court register, we signed in the register that to death do us part. No. A marriage cannot be by force. So there are those of us who believe in Nigeria, contested to be president of Nigeria. But if and when I get tired, and it's looking like everybody is getting tired, then we talk. If you cannot commit a crime by saying your mind, this is where those who are attacking the agitators are missing the point. If you don't want them to agitate, if you don't want them to say they are going, then show them some love. It's simple. No matter what you say today, they have turned Sunday Igboho into a folk hero. His name, he has joined the pantheon of Yoruba gods. Shangolukusu Okoya, Oromiya, and the rest of them. He has joined them. He has joined them. Either advertently or inadvertently. Government has played into his hand, and now they have apotheosized this gentleman. Sunday Igboho on his own, what can he do? What can he do? But the man was brave, the man was bold to speak. There is nothing he spoke that the Sheikh Gumins and others have not spoken. So, if I will advise this government as I always do, and it's just a pity because I don't even know if the president is aware of some of these things, but if I have access to him, I'll advise him, leave the Sunday Igboho alone. In fact, the Sunday Igboho are not the problems of Nigeria. They are not the problems of Nigeria because those who talk, it means that they are only dreaming, it means they are only talking. Those who don't talk, they are the ones you should be careful about. The dangerous people are those who don't talk. They are the plotters. They are the, they don't talk. They will not come in public and say their minds. Igbo never left his house until you invaded his house. So somebody wants to fight government, will he sit down at home and wait for you? But when he saw the avalanche of weapons facing his house, he took off. He took off. The Yorubas have a saying, any job, they don't care, locally. It's a man who has not seen a war, who calls himself a man. He took off. So a man who wants to fight government will not take off and travel abroad. The man, all he was doing was to rally his people to say, no, you cannot just sit down in your farmlands and allow these Fulani herdsmen to come and ravage your farmlands, to come and rape your daughters and your wives, to come and kill your people, and the police will not do jack. That's all. That's all he has done. That's all he has done. So, for those who talk about asylum, again, I applied for asylum, and I wish to publicly once again thank the British government. They gave me fair hearing. I sat through an interview, myself and my wife. She did not speak because I was applying on behalf of the family. I had suitcases with me showing my work, my writings, videos of my activities in Nigeria. In fact, the lady who interviewed me told me he's been in the Home Office for about 20 years. He has never seen a case as straightforward as mine. And I was absolutely certain that I'll be granted asylum. I don't know of how many people, I don't know of anybody who had full asylum like I did. I was granted full asylum with my entire family. And I'm very grateful, eternally grateful to the British government. They gave us maximum protection. They gave us everything that we needed. So I needed to speak up as someone who has gone through it before. And if Igbo's lawyers are successful on Monday, he may be allowed to go. He may be allowed to go. I don't know where his final destination was when he was traveling with his wife, but it's obvious that his wife, both of them, had German passports, and if so, so I'm sure they'll be able to settle in Germany. And then the government can go to rest. At least they know one of their so-called enemies will be out of the way. In Germany, the German government will not allow them to wage any war against anybody or any country. So, like William Shakespeare would have put it, all is well that ends well. I don't know why we are expending too much energy on pursuing people who have not carried weapons, when those who are shooting down, you know, fighter jets are sitting pretty in their evil forests. I don't know why. So my advice again to President Muhammadu Buhari is that, look, you have too many problems in your hands. Begin to reduce it one by one. You don't need all this stress. As I said, the president has less than 2 years to go, unless there is a plan that we are not aware of. So by now, any government should be winding down. I know of a governor in the South who has already left the government house. He said, I have less than 2 years to go. I don't want to get too comfortable in the government house. I'm going to my house. The governor Yusuf Wike has already moved to his house. He's already launching and commissioning his projects and showing it to the whole world to say, this is my legacy. And that is what I expect the government to be doing now. I traveled through Lagos Ibadan Express in the last few days. In fact, when we were coming back, we had to leave Ibadan at 5 a.m. because just that road, which happens to be, for me, the most important road in Nigeria, linking the nerve center of business, of commerce, Lagos, to the rest of Nigeria, in 6 years, it has not been completed. Some people spend 12 hours driving on that road. If our government, that would concern me. In fact, the more government can do now to